For everyone's information, we are live captioning our meetings. Please look in the chat window of our WebEx meeting where you will find a link. Please click on that link to open a web page with the live captioning. Good. So at this time, I call to order the regular meeting of the Maricopa County Community College District Governing Board for December 13, 2022. For the record, I'm going to call roll of members. I'm going to start with our student trustee, Mr. Burnett.
Present.
Thank you. Ms. Bittersmith.
Here.
Thank you. Ms. McGrath.
Present.
Thank you. Dr. Nerini.
Present.
Ms. Smith.
Present.
Thank you. Dr. Thor.
Present.
Ms. Nguyen.
Present.
With my present, 7 board members are present. Might say this is rather exciting. We're all seated here together. Wow. It's wonderful. And our student trustee is also present. So good evening, everyone, and delighted to see you all in the audience as well. Before we go to the pledge, I've been asked many times what happened to my arm. I'm just going to tell you that I was leaping off tall buildings in a single bound. And we'll go with that. Now I'd like to move to the Pledge of Allegiance. Mr. Saar, our guest this evening, would you please lead us in the pledge?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Mr. Saar. So we have a full meeting this evening, and I have received no notification of substitutes. So our first item on the agenda this evening is the faculty executive report. Dr. Newton, good evening. Nice to see you. Thank you.
I don't have to keep my finger on it. Good. Okay. It does. Good evening, President Sullivan, board members, Chancellor Gonzalez, CEC members, colleagues, and guests. I started out the year by letting you know that faculty were excited to meet students where they were at the beginning of the semester. I'm pleased to say we did that with joy, and we are now scrambling and working hard to support students so that they can get across the finish line and complete. I want to thank, on behalf of faculty, I want to thank all of you for supporting us so that we're able to support those students. We appreciate everything you've done. Sasha set a very high bar last year, and I don't want to discontinue tradition, but I'm not going to sing. I will, however, offer the following semester wrappings. 'Tis a night before fall's end, and wrapping up at each college is a semester's pursuit of teaching, learning, and knowledge. The faculty have crafted their finals with care. In confidence, students will all come prepared. Staff and admin support, as they always do, offering talent and resources and enrollment FAQs. The chancellor and governing board are focused on vision, refining our priorities, strategic plan, and mission. We collaborate together, shared governance the way. We progress as a district for tomorrow and today. And the students, our true focus, they persist and persevere, move through obstacles and challenges to dreams of transfer and career. Their efforts show us all that education means opportunity, that MCCD at its core exists to serve its communities. And so the year ends, star of service shining bright. Happy holidays to all, and to all a good fortnight. Thank you.
Dr. Gonzalez, is she helping to write the strategic plan? Thank you. We now have our Adjunct Faculty Association report. Thank you, Mr. Frankowick, for being with us.
Chairperson, board members, distinguished educators, and friends. I wanted to start today by saying that I was driving around in my car this week and I heard this meeting getting advertised on the radio. And I'm like, they're hyping my gig. This is so fantastic. I turned up the radio and I rolled down the windows. And so I really appreciate you doing that. And I would like to say that I hope that anyone who is listening tonight because of that outreach keeps listening to KJZZ, keeps wanting to hear meeting updates and becomes more involved, because there's a lot of great things happening here. And the more that they know about what's going on, the better off we are. So thanks for that Mick Jagger moment of Mick Jagger 1962, not 1992. But still, I really appreciate that. That was a cool feeling. So thank you. I also have a wrapping up theme to my presentation. So if we could go to the next slide, please. There are new representatives. This is one of the great things, but these are some of the things we've been doing. There are new representatives. We're onboarding them. They're set to start in January when their contracts start. We're working to get everyone ready. Dr. Smith has really helped out getting the people at Rio going. We're partnering new and existing representatives where that's available, but where we're not, we're taking a little bit of extra time to get everybody going from 0 to 60. Paradise Valley has taken extra steps to really help us out. Dr. Hunter's really been instrumental in that, to get a presence on their campus. And the great news, one of the great things, is we are firing on all cylinders now, and we have adjunct faculty representation at each of the 10 campuses. So that is fantastic. Before, we did not have that. We do now. That's fantastic. So next slide, please. Because we now have 18 people instead of just 10, we can restart the work of our internal committees in earnest. I'm sorry, did you fix it? Gotcha. So for instance, we now have 18 people instead of 10, so we can restart the work of our internal committees. We're currently seeking comments from our membership on one of the committees to get the bylaws that we operate under. Our committees will use these suggestions in making a presentation to the entire group to better formalize our practices and restart their efforts. Some of our committees have been going on like a bare bones thing because we've only had like 10 out of 20 people. But now that we have the more people, we can get them all up and running. So that's fantastic. Next slide, please. So furthest from great in the adjunct faculty world is that our branding efforts have suffered a setback. We have to regroup and restart to get the word out about our group, the expertise that adjunct faculty bring to the table, and the benefit that we are to adjunct faculty members. I worked here quite some time before I realized exactly everything that the adjunct faculty association and employee group does. And I want to fix that. And so our summer presentation and planning committees are set to build on the progress that we're planning to establish in the spring, just getting that whole initiative restarted. Okay, next slide, please. In wrapping up 2022 and my first semester as president, I have to say that I have a ridiculously deep well of talent at my disposal. And that's made it very easy to accomplish our objectives. We're not just a community billboard I was joking about last meeting, you know, with a shot of the nurse, the teacher, the policeman, the retiree, the musician, and small business owner. But whenever our group starts working on initiatives, invariably someone says, oh, I used to do that professionally, and offers their expertise in that effort. Next slide, please. Well, we seldom need police intervention or emergency medical care at our meetings. We often rely on people with previous paid experience doing the exact things that we ask them to do. We have a public relations expert, successful marketers, professional designers, mathematicians, working artists, and psychologists. So we have a deep well of talent. Next slide, please. It just makes sense for me to take full advantage of the expertise our guys have. I wouldn't stand before you saying I was running things without taking advantage of that expertise. That would be a waste of your time to listen to me. As a representative of the whole adjunct faculty group, I hope that we can expand on the number and types of opportunities in which adjuncts can use our expertise to serve the interests of the Maricopa Community College District. That just, you already got guys dedicated to the cause. We're ready to help. Next slide, please. So thank you. While adjuncts have varied motivations for doing a part-time job, all of us appreciate the extra income that goes with having a side gig. For many, this is the exact time of year when having that extra paycheck shows why the effort was worth it. But I can tell you that almost all of us will mention working at the community college, while we enjoy our holiday specialties on extended tables with our dearest folks in the coming weeks and in the past few weeks. Thank you for running the operation that makes such a mention possible. It's more of a boast than a conversation starter. So thank you. Thank you.
Happy holidays. Thank you. We now have our staff representative update from Ms. Shannon Mange, Mr. Calvin Duvall. Good evening.
President Sullivan, governing board members, presidents, Chancellor Gonzalez, CEC, my name is Kelvin Duvall and the co-president of staff representation. With that, I want to hand it off to Shannon Mange.
Thank you, Calvin. President Sullivan, members of the board, Chancellor Gonzalez, members of CEC and guests, my name is Shannon Mange and I'm here before you today as co-president for staff representation. Before I begin, I would like to say thank you to my colleague, Calvin Duvall, who has handled these presentations the last few months as I've been able to take time from work and be a mom and be there for my son during his fall baseball season. Chancellor, they had an amazing season this year. He's excited for spring ball. Dr. Leshinsky, he's improved in pitching. He may actually be a starter in spring. So fingers crossed. Now on to our presentation. Next slide, please. As we have tried to celebrate Heritage Month every month in our presentations, we'd like to mention that December is Universal Human Rights Month. December 10th, every month, every year, is Human Rights Day. This is the 75th anniversary of that day becoming an official recognized holiday nationally. The 2022 theme is Dignity, Freedom, and Justice for All. So if you guys would like further information on how to celebrate this at your campuses or in your community, the links are in our presentation, which is also available on the Board Doc website. I also encourage you to talk to your campuses and see how they are celebrating. PVCC's library is putting resources together through their library website on Human Rights Month, and Mesa Community College Engagement Center is sharing daily on the Bill of Rights celebration because that day is December 15th. So I encourage you guys to look for more information on how to celebrate that day and that month. Next slide, please. Calvin and I are continuing our collaboration across the district. Calvin and I will be serving on the Provost and Executive Vice Chancellor Search Committee, and we thank Georgetta Kelly and her team for allowing that opportunity to participate in that. We know this is a huge, huge position for our district, and we look forward to collaborating and bringing the best candidates forward. Calvin has been instrumental in putting together a plan for performance management, and that has been a huge task that we have taken on along with colleagues across the district, especially within HR, so we look forward to sharing that work with you guys coming forward. The 25 load implementation task force has been doing great work for our faculty, and we thank them greatly for allowing staff to be part of those conversations because we know operationally staff are going to be a huge part of that once the decisions are made. Calvin and I are continuing with our one-on-one tours with our college presidents and our HR directors, and we cannot thank them enough for the open, transparent conversations that we are having because we all want to make Maricopa better for our students and for our employees. So we look forward to a final report out and future collaboration next semester. Next slide, please. Our representative highlights for this month come from Phoenix College. Your non-exempt reps are Todd Fleming, Travis Maldonado, and Vashi Worley Moore. Todd Fleming also serves as your senator. Next slide, please. Your exempt representatives are Aaron Love, Michael Wainscott, and Michael Matos. They have done wonders for Phoenix College and conversations across the district, and we are very lucky to be working with them. Next slide, please. And now I will turn it over to Calvin Duvall, whose other hat that he wears is our MVET president.
So we just quickly wanted to congratulate the MVET Challenge victor this year, which is Paradise Valley Community College. It was a very tight race. They won by 2 points over PC. I know, right? We had some really good participation district-wide. We ended up gathering 4 pallets of food and hygiene products for the Mana House, which is an organization that helps homeless veterans. So congratulations again, Paradise Valley.
I can't help but to clap really loud because PV is my home campus. So I'm very, very happy for them. They did a wonderful job. So we'd like to end our presentation by wishing everybody a Merry Christmas, Feliz Navidad. Whatever holiday that you celebrate this month with your family, friends, and loved ones, we hope that you get to refresh, re-energize, and get ready for the spring semester. We wish you all health and happiness. That is it.
Thank you very much. Happy holidays to all of you too. We now have our student life reports. We're going to welcome our Phoenix College Student Life and Leadership Group. And I believe our students are here with their advisors, Mr. Mosier and Ms. Martinez. Invited them to introduce students, but I see as you're lining up, you're going to introduce yourselves. That's great. So good evening. It's great to have you with us. This is always the highlight of a board meeting, you know. Yeah, no pressure.
At all.
Okay.
Okay, perfect. I'm not shaking or anything. Don't worry. Okay. Perfect. And that's presenting? Okay. Good evening, President Sullivan, members of the board, Dr. Gonzalez, members of the CEC and guests. My name is Landon Kea, president of the Phoenix College United Student Government. My major is cybersecurity and leadership, and I will graduate in 2023. Next slide, please. My fellow executive officers and I are honored to present all the exciting things that are happening at Phoenix College. Next slide, please. We would like to share with you our culture of connection from the 2022 fall semester, highlighting community engagement, advocacy work, student involvement, and academic outreach. Next, Samantha Serpa will be speaking on the topic of academic outreach. Next slide, please.
Good evening. My name is Samantha Serpa. I am the PC United Vice President of Communications. I am planning to get my Associates of Art in the spring of 2023 and transferring to ASU to study journalism. Next slide, please. Our STEAM Fair, FOI Expo, International Education Week, and Behavioral Science Fair were our events that highlighted academic significance and opportunities to our students on campus. STEAM Fair provided students information about careers and opportunities in this field, which highlights science, technology, engineering, arts, and mathematics. The FOI Expo was an event that highlighted each student's fields of interest, which helps students receive better knowledge about their academic field. For example, culture and society, performing arts, and behavioral sciences. International Education Week celebrated multiculturalism by hosting a variety of events throughout the week with an opening ceremony, international dances, and a multicultural performance. Next slide, please. Next is Rayleigh Lewis, who will speak about student advocacy.
Good evening. My name is Rayleigh Lewis, Vice President of Advocacy. My major is Biological Sciences, and I'm graduating in spring of 2024. Next slide, please. Advocacy for our students and campus is incredibly important to PC. This semester, we've had numerous pilot programs focused on supporting the needs of our students. The first is the Bumstead Resource Room, powered by Whataburger, which provides non-perishable food items, school supplies, toiletries, and baby supplies, and currently serves around 65 students a week. Next, we had the opening of Bear's Closet, and it provides both casual and PC also saw the start of the Single Stop program, which helps make things easier for students in need to access community resources. PC also hosted our annual baby shower, which provides student parents with baby needs as well as fun toys. Next slide, please. Next is Imelda Hartley, who will be talking about civic engagement.
Good evening, my name is Imelda Hartley. I'm PC Student Senator. I'm planning to get my Associates of Arts with emphasis on social work, and I will be graduating in 2023. We are proud to tell you of the various civic engagements that we have hosted at Phoenix College. This year, PC is committed to engaging the community in voter education and voter registration. On September 20, PC hosted Voter Registration Day and Voter Education Day on campus. A student life and leadership partnered with the Liberal Arts Department to host Constitution Day with Maricopa County Recorder Stephen Richard on campus to discuss the importance of voter engagement. In addition, Dr. Albert Celosa, Liberal Arts faculty, hosted an Arizona election forum to educate the PC community on the various ballot propositions and initiatives. We also engage our community through services such as our Adapt AS3 program on November 7, where students engaged in a street cleanup and met with Mayor Kay Gallegos and Maricopa Board President Maria Sullivan. PC also continues its support of the community through a mobile food distribution program. And to talk about student involvement, I would like to turn it over to Damaris Cano Martinez. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Damaris Cano Martinez, and I'm the Vice President of Involvement. My major is chemistry, and I am graduating in 2023. Student involvement for PC students on the campus community is incredibly important to us. We have various opportunities for PC students to engage, such as homecoming, where a theme was There Is No Place Like Home, and the Monster Batch, which saw over 200 people attend this year. PC students also participated in a three-day leadership retreat in Prescott, where students from all Maricopa community colleges collaborated and learned about ways on how to become successful leaders. Next slide, please. PC also provided opportunities for students to get involved with the causes they care most about. With a supply drive for the unsheltered and a series of speeches from prominent community leaders such as Saul Flores and the Behavioral Science Fair, which brought awareness to mental health. Here is Landon Key to bring our presentation to a close.
As you can see, we've been busy at Phoenix College. We also like to take a moment specifically to recognize our men and women of our soccer teams who made an outstanding postseason run, capping it off with the women's soccer team winning the NJCAA National Championships. We are proud to be Bears and love our connection to Phoenix College, the flagship of Maricopa Community College District. We wish you all a safe and happy holiday. Thank you and good night. We're open to receive any questions or comments at this time.
We'd like to wish you a very happy holiday. We're delighted that you've been here, and I'm a Bear myself, so I'm going to say, go Bears. Thank you for being with us this evening. Appreciate it. Be safe going home. Thank you. And thank you to your advisors for bringing you here this evening. So now we move to a really fun part of the evening. We have three awards and recognitions that we want to share. First one is we're going to welcome a previous governing board member. And before I ask Mr. Saar to go to the podium, I have a long list of things that you do that I need here to read. But maybe you could stand there and then you can be recognized that way. And then as soon as I'm done reading this long list of achievements, we'll be glad to share our award with you. So this is Mr. Dana Saar, and Mr. Saar worked on our governing board for 10 years. I think that deserves a lot of applause. When I joined the board, I had 2 years to share with you on the board, and I have to say before I get into your long list that I really learned a lot from you and really felt your interest in guiding us new board members to be better board members. And I remember you taking on the policy work and trying to hold a whip to our feet to make sure that we address that. I don't know that we were very successful, but it wasn't because you didn't try. So we appreciate all the effort and energy that you put into our board in that regard. We know you're a CTE champion, and I expect that maybe you'll put a plug in for that before the evening's over. And we also know that you were the leader of the pack when it came to national recognition and support to our district. In fact, maybe Dr. Nerini will remember with me that we were brand new board members going to our first Association of Community College trustee meeting. And Ms. Nguyen, I believe you were with us as well. And everyone asked when we said Maricopa County, do you know Mr. Saar? Is Dana here? Is he hiding? Are you meeting with Mr. Saar? You know, he served on this committee, did that. So our reputation was not Maricopa Community College's, it was Mr. Dana Saar. Would you agree with that, Ms. Nguyen? And Dr. Thor was with us, Dr. Nerini? All right, so let me tell you why. The Association Community College Trustees is an organization that we all belong to and is to inform us to become better board members. So Mr. Saar was involved with that during the entire 10 years that he served on our board. And this is what he did. First of all, he attended every single national conference. That takes dedication, and we respect that quite a bit. You attended six or more governance leadership institutes, and having been to a few, those are exhausting, constantly learning, but you were at every one, and you were also leading learnings in those capacities when you were there. He also served on the Association of Community College Trustee Governing Board. Can't say that any of us really aspire to do that, but following in your footsteps, I think maybe someday one of us, but thank you for that, because that was really important. He also served on the ACCT Board's Mission and Vision Committee, setting the stage for what they're doing now and guiding and supporting community colleges throughout the United States. He served as a member and chair of the ACCT Trustee Advisory Committee. One more. And he chaired the Pacific Region Nominating Committee. And the person to follow you in those footsteps was Dr. Linda Thor. So you put out in a good word for Maricopa Community Colleges. That's why they asked Linda to do that too. And you also made presentations and served on panels at leadership congresses. So keeping in mind with all that, we the board believed that for these reasons that Mr. Saar, you should be recognized with a lifetime membership in recognition of your outstanding service to ACCT. So, Mr. Saar, we would like to present you, board members, with this with the lifetime membership award presented to Mr. Dana Saar, Maricopa County Community College District, in recognition of your service and leadership on behalf of community colleges from the Association of Community College Trustees this October 2022. But we wanted to save it until December when we could have you join us. So with that, board members, round of applause for Mr.
I'm still a board member in the K-12 world and don't want to give me a microphone very long. So, President Sullivan, governing board members, Chancellor, CEC, and guests, and Elsa. Thank you very much for this award. I enjoyed every 10 minutes of those 10 years. You know, elected officials oftentimes struggle to begin with. I came onto this board with some experience in the K-12 world, but I came more importantly with other governing board members. There were only five of us at the time that helped me get going. And over the 10 years, I had a chance to meet a lot of board members and a lot of board members across the United States, and I've always been very proud to be a Maricopan. Now I'm a Thunderbird at Mesa. I'm teaching as an adjunct, and I'm also teaching back in K-12. So I'm keeping busy, but I really appreciate this. So thank you very much.
Thank you for taking the time to join us this evening. That was very nice. So now we have two more recognitions. As you know, we're elected as board members to serve four-year terms. And some people choose to run again and some people choose not. In this instance, we have a board member who ran and has now served 8 years on our governing board, but who is moving on. And before I comment further on the award, I'm just going to give you some personal reflections on Mrs. Jean McGrath. She served from 2015 to 2022 as the District 4 representative. I heard a lot about Mrs. McGrath before I came on the board. Some of it's scary. Why do I know that? You know, I and some of it rewarding, and gave me an opportunity to form my own point of view. I find Mrs. McGrath to be a person of great integrity in what she believes and what she represents. Then in today's world of people vacillating and finding their positions convenient, that was never an experience I have had personally with Mrs. McGrath. Do you notice how many people are shaking their heads? Okay. The other thing I know about Mrs. McGrath is that she cares about people. Whenever I speak with Mrs. McGrath on a personal phone call, the first thing she asks me is, how am I? Then she asks, how's my husband? Thinking that maybe I've done something to him or something. I don't know what. And then now that I have a granddaughter, she asks me, how's your granddaughter? And that extension of herself to show care and appreciation for who I am really stands out to me. It's been an honor to serve with you because of those characteristics. And frankly, I'm going to miss the PA moments and you holding us accountable to different points of view. And I wish you the best in whatever it is that you choose to do next. And I know it'll be something that has impact. So, Mrs. McGrath, in appreciation.
That's it.
In recognition of your guidance, leadership, and commitment serving as a member of Maricopa County College District Governing Board. Congratulations.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
It's been a real pleasure to serve on this board, and especially to serve with the wonderful people that work for the district. It was a revelation to me, the quality of personnel that we have here. It's just been very, very exciting and rewarding, and I thank you all for this experience.
So now there's another board member who chose not to run again because she was too busy doing other things, and we won't hold that against you. And that is Mrs. Nguyen, who served on the governing board from 2019 through 2022 as an at-large representative. So Mrs. Nguyen, you and I have had some differences. And I want to respect that you brought that to those differences to the table. I think that with your interest and investment in the issues and concerns that you believe in strongly, that you both challenged us and compelled us to be thoughtful governing board members in a new way. And those are characteristics that I know you bring to all of your work. I particularly want to offer respect for the work you do with women and families who are victims of violence and other concerns, your investment with law enforcement to ensure that they save the day. I know many of our police officers here know you personally and know of that passion that you bring. We wish you the best in your work in Tucson or wherever else that may bring you. and honor the work that you did contribute to our governing board. And it's been, I'm sorry, won't be going forward with you in the next 4 years, but wish you again the best of luck. And with that, Mrs. Wynn.
Yes. Oh, you want me to?
Button. Maricopa Community Colleges, with our appreciation, we hereby honor Ms. Kathleen Wynn in recognition of your guidance, leadership, and commitment to serving as a member of Maricopa County Community College District Governing Board 2019 to 2022, December 13th, 2022. Thank you very much.
Can I just take them just a moment?
Sure.
I just want to say that the last 4 years have taught me a lot. And I'm so glad you're here tonight, Dana, because everything that Ms. Sullivan said is true. You really tried to instill in us so much that the community college offered and tried to make us better board members. And we tried. And occasionally I would get texts from Dana, keep going. So that was always encouraging, and I appreciate that. I got the benefit of working with a lot of great people, Brian Spicker, and there's so many of you, and I don't, the college presidents are still here. There's been a big turnover. But I learned, and like Mrs. McGrath said, we have some incredible people in this college system. It is an amazing system, and we should be very proud of it. And as we go forward, and hopefully there's no COVID in our future, that we re-engage the community in what a great system that this is. I will always be proud of the time that I spent here and grateful for the friendships and being able to support people, whether they liked what was going on in the college or not going. It was always my commitment to make sure that they were heard and that we did the best we could for whatever their concerns were. And I have relocated to Tucson, Arizona. So my home of the Wildcats, go Wildcats. And woo, we beat the Sun Devils. I'm sorry, don't want to end on a down note, but I will tell you that I can't even express the amount of contribution that I've been contributed to, and it's changed me as a person, and I really am grateful. And so I wish everybody the very best, and thank you for this acknowledgement this evening.
Thank you, Mrs. Wynn. Before we move on, I want to remind everyone that we have some refreshments this evening out the door. I believe there's some yummy cookies and some water and lemonade coffee. And now that we're trapped, Dr. Gonzalez, would you let us take a few minutes if people want to get a refreshment because they're trapped?
That could be part of my chancellor's update.
Whatever you choose. Shall we take 5 minutes? Can we do that?
Absolutely.
Okay, let's take 5 minutes. Please help yourself to some refreshments. And it is 7:12, and we will be here. Literally, I will be gaveling the gavel in 5 minutes. Well, that was a nice interlude. Thank you all for accommodating us. Now we'll move to the chancellor's report on the agenda. Dr. Gonzalez.
Thank you, President Sullivan, governing board members, CEC. I almost said Chancellor Gonzalez, but I'm right here. And anyhow, and our guests that are with us this evening, thank you for being here. My update will be very brief. And one of the first things I'd like to do is extend my thank you and congratulations to our outgoing board members. It's been a pleasure working with both of you as well. And it's good to see Mr. Sarr here as well, and to congratulate him on his honor. And I don't know if it's irony, but maybe just a matter of coincidence, but we had Jihang Lee, who was in town yesterday presenting for ELI, the League for Innovation Executive Leadership Institute. And he said that after 10 o'clock, he'd be available and like to visit a couple of our colleges if possible. So in true Maricopa fashion, we had some folks respond very quickly and put together a wonderful day where he got to visit Phoenix Forge, the 18th Street location, the CEI location at Gateway, and then we spent the afternoon over at Scottsdale where we spent some time learning about interior design. And I'd shared with Dr. Luzinski that that was the area of Home Depot that if I looked was looking for my wife, that's where I would find her. So I was very familiar with the patterns that were there. We got to visit the Culinary Arts Program and then the Center for Native and Urban Wildlife, which I would encourage anyone to go and visit. I mean, this thing rivals the Phoenix Zoo's amphibious display. So I just want to say thank you for everybody that had a hand in that. He left extremely impressed. And one of the things that really blew him away is when he visited the CEI, he said, my goodness, they're making human tissue in that place and they're sending it all over the world. So he was really excited. So thank you for that. And that leads me to my final words as we close out this, not only the fall semester, but the calendar year, to say thank you to all of you for your extraordinary commitment, your leadership, your unwavering dedication to the Maricopa system, to the jobs that you do each and every day. From the bottom of my heart, I'm extremely appreciative of all of your work. And I want to wish you all a wonderful holiday season, that you're safe, you're healthy, you're blessed through it all. And I look forward to coming back in January and picking up where we left off, rested and ready for a wonderful spring semester. And then we'll move into the implementation of a new strategic plan. So that's all I want for Christmas is a new strategic plan. Thank you.
I don't think you're alone. May Santa Claus bring it to you. Oh, wait a minute. It's sleigh bells. Now it is our opportunity to turn to citizens interim. And as you know, this is an opportunity for our members of the public to address the governing board. We have one person this evening who wants to speak during the citizens interim. That's Ms. LaJuan Pleasant. Ms. Pleasant, would you like to join us at the podium, please? Or come to the podium? Thank you. Happy holidays to you.
How's that?
Perfect.
Okay, start over. My time starts over. Good evening, Madam President, Chancellor Gonzalez, Governing Board members, CEC, family and friends. So good to see you, Dr. Starr. I wanted to bring that to your attention. Sorry to see you leave, Mrs. McGrath. I've always appreciated your contribution to the different meetings that I hear you participate in. Sad to come to you once again to let you know that I still not resolved resolution regarding the policy and procedures at the Maricopa Community Colleges fails to uphold to when a person files a complaint of discrimination / retaliation. I don't know if any of you have ever experienced that, but let me tell you, it doesn't feel well, which is why I've been here for the last two and a half years. I've been gathering information from the Ombudsman's Office in reference to Stacey Gabriel and the Office of Jones, Skelton, Hopchley, the attorney that you all hired, Gordon Lewis. I've been receiving this information. I've got about maybe 3,000 pages worth of investigative information, most recently 300 pages from the Ombudsman's Office. They let me know they've got another batch of information to provide to me. My hope and prayer is that the Maricopa Community Colleges District will stand on the integrity that you are elected to be placed in. You're supposed to be truthful and honest in all the dealings, and our president is, and our chancellor, excuse me, is to ensure that the policy and procedures have been executed truthfully and with merit. I've got information to share. I won't share it in this public environment. I was thinking maybe instead of continuously coming before the governing board, I'll just meet with my District 5 representative, Mr. Tom Naraney, and then we'll present it to you in another format. So that's about my couple minutes for now, and I thank you so much for this time, and God bless you all. Happy holidays.
Thank you, Ms. Pleasant. We'll now move to consideration of the consent agenda and all items under this section of the agenda consent matters unless they are removed from the consent agenda at this time. Do any board members or the chancellor wish to remove any item from the consent agenda? Dr. Naraney?
I don't, but I have a question.
Okay.
I don't know if I missed the information we'd asked about For the curriculum, we ask about the information.
Dr. Nerini, in order for us to talk about any item on the consent agenda, I need you to remove it.
Would not like to remove anything from the agenda.
Are you sure? Is there another way that you'll be able to get your information?
I can ask it afterwards.
Okay. So with that, is there a motion to approve the consent?
So moved.
Thank you. Is there a second?
I'll second it after all that.
Thank you, Dr. Nerini. So all of those in favor of supporting consent agenda as presented, please vote by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Being none, the consent agenda passes as presented. I included the student advisory vote in that. Do you have a comment or a vote on the consent agenda, Mr. Burnett? Thank
you. No, ma'am.
Thank you. All right, now moving to the non-consent action items. The first item is the second read and adoption of staff policy proposals regarding bereavement leave, catastrophic illness, imminent death leave, sick leave, grievance, discipline. Is there a motion to adopt staff policy proposals regarding those items?
So moved.
Thank you, Ms. Nguyen. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Dr. Thor. Are there any comments or questions for discussion under the motion? Being none, I'll call roll call vote. Mr. Burnett, I'll start with you as our student trustee. Thank
Aye.
You. Ms. Bittersmith?
Aye.
Thank you. Mrs. McGrath?
Aye.
Dr. Nerini?
Aye.
Ms. Smith?
Aye.
Dr. Thor?
Aye.
Ms. Nguyen?
Aye.
My vote is aye as well, and the item passes with 7-0 board member support and the student trustee voting as well. The next item on our agenda is the approval of a proposed tuition rate increase for beginning in fiscal year 23-24. With that, I'm going to make the motion to approve a base tuition rate of $97 a credit hour beginning fiscal year 23-24. Is there a second on my motion?
Second.
Thank you, Dr. Thor. We now move to discussion under the motion, and I'd like to first listen for public comment. I believe we have someone present as a panelist this evening, Mr. Nate Roton, who's CEO of 1 in 10 nonprofit. Mr. Roton, are you able to hear us? He's not in person. Elsa?
Yes, President Sullivan, can you hear me?
I can. Hi, Nate.
Perfect. Hello, President Sullivan, esteemed board members, Chancellor Gonzalez, CEC, and guests. As President Sullivan already motioned, I am speaking on behalf of in support of the tuition increase. And on behalf of the organization that I am the CEO of, 1 in 10, the youth and young adult population we serve, I support the tuition increase. Not only has the district been conservative with the request, but without an increase over the last 10 years, the inflationary impacts of the last year alone are worthy of this growth in tuition cost. The college district is an invaluable tool for our young people and a leading asset in our community. Maintaining the quality of education is an investment in our county, our residents, and the businesses and organization calling Maricopa County home. I urge the board to support the proposed increase tonight. Thank you for your time and happy holidays.
Thank you, Mr. Roton. I also have a collection of cards from some presenters. Mr. Connor, I can never say your last name, Hotgar. I beg your pardon. Thank you. Please come to the podium. Also, Ms. Imelda Hartley, Ms. Heather Rayom, please join us at the podium. And I have your speaking cards in front of me. As you know, speaking to the board, while some are not speaking, they're there for moral support, from what I understand. So you're a group of students, and so Connor, I'll start with you.
Okay, greetings, Madam President, members of the board, Chancellor Gonzalez, et cetera, et cetera. My name is Connor Horan. I am chair of the Maricopa Student Senate. As far as this vote goes, it's, I know it's a hot button item. I see both sides of it. And I reckon I'm here to provide a student perspective. And students don't see the budget. They just see, you know, the tuition's going up, you know, what's in it for me. And from a personal standpoint, you know, I've had good and bad experiences with, you know, what I feel is the return on investment from the money and time I've put in. But I don't know, I pretty much, I trust the board to make the right decision. With the Student Senate, I've been, had my eyes open to a lot of different student experiences, and I've talked to most board members to some degree, and they're all always willing to listen. And I don't know, I just, I basically, I trust in you all to make the right decision. That's about all I have to say.
Thank you. Thank you, Connor. Ms. Hartley?
Thank you, Madam President, Sullivan, members of the board, Councilor Gonzalez. My name is Imelda Harley. I'm PC student senator. And just want to say that I'm here in support for the tuition increase. And before I go any further, I just want to say one of the great benefits I receive as a student at Phoenix College is that I get to access the Whataburger food distributions twice a week. That means I get to get 20 items, and if that means a total of 80 a month, I mean, that is a huge, huge saving for me as a single parent, over $100 that I get. My kids love the waffle pancake mix, you name it. And then also I get school supplies. In addition to that, I just wanna say these beautiful pants that I'm wearing tonight is part of the Carissa Cercenes, where we can go and get a professional outfit. And that's why I'm in support that tuition increase to be less than $100, because as a student, I get so much from Maricopa Community College. Thank you.
Thank you. I have one more card as opposed to two. Was someone supposed to present? I know there are five of you up at the podium. I have a card from Heather.
Yeah.
If you would like to fill out another card quickly, I can listen. We can listen to Heather. Okay. Oh, you just want to introduce yourself. Excuse me. Okay, go ahead, please.
Madam President, members of the board, Chancellor Gonzalez, my name is Akari Hashimoto. I am the student senator for Scottsdale Community College. So thank you, Dr. Eric, for that. I just wanted to say that I'm proud to be here tonight. And so thank you for having me. And I'm just here to support everything that's going on. Thank okay. you.
Thank you. And you're, and Heather.
Yes.
Thank you.
Madam President, members of the board, Chancellor Gonzalez. My name is Heather Rayom. I'm the student senator for Paradise Valley Community College. I agree with my peers. We definitely know that this is a difficult decision to make and that it's been heavy for the last 10 years. And we appreciate that you've supported us in this decision. Today, I'm here to say that I support the tuition increase, and like my peer has shared, we appreciate everything that the school does to create an amazing student experience. And so we want to invest in this institution. We want it to continue, and we believe that if we are able to fund it, that it will continue for many more years. One of the things that I think it might be an opportunity for us to do is to create some KPIs for our professors so that we can measure the student experience and maybe report on it so that we can see the return of our investment, as Connor put it. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. I don't have any other cards for public comments, so now I will turn comments to governing board members. There is a motion and a second on the floor. We're moving to board discussion, and I had already been flagged by Mr. Burnett. He'd like to offer comment initially. So Mr. Burnett, do you have any comments or points of discussion this evening?
Well, yes, as a member of the new flagship for Maricopa County, Chandler Gilbert. I'd like to say, first of all, congratulations to all the senators that spoke. You know, there's an old flagship and then there's a new flagship, and that would be us. I think I said this a couple meetings ago, and I'll try and just hit bullet comments and then pass it on. Is that number one, I'm a full-time student as well, and I try to calculate the impact to me as personally, like I was calculating the impact to any student. What would a $10 or $12 an hour increase come out to? And it would be one night at a Braves game or a, what's the team here? Cardinals?
Yeah.
Whatever the team is here.
Obviously, you haven't gone.
You know, I mean, it's a little over $300 a year impact to me. And I think if somebody went in my bank account and took out $300 sometime in a year, it probably wouldn't ruin me. I'd probably figure it out. And for what I'm getting, the quality of the education that I receive, that I feel like I receive here, is worth much more than that. It's a new baseline. You know, the students here, the senators, me as a governing board person, representative, the students at the 10 community colleges, they'll feel the impact next year. But the kids that are in the 11th and 12th grade in high school, they won't. Because remember, they're going to come in and that is their baseline. It's $97 a credit hour. That's their baseline. And they're still looking at that and comparing it to GCU and ASU and U of A and all the other schools and calculating that they could spend 2 years at a community college and get a good quality education, even an associate's degree, and a start on their bachelor's degree at 1/10 the cost it would cost them anywhere else. So remember, we're talking about this tuition increase like it's going to affect everybody in that's ever going to come into the community college system, and it's not. It really affects the people who see the growth, who see the increase from now till then. But those new students, that's their baseline, and that's what they're going to know. That's all they're going to know. And it's still an absolutely incredible return on investment for what we're putting into it. And we have a choice. Obviously, the board members have a difficult decision to make, but you know, we can operate in the red or we can operate in the black. And you know, we start digging that hole and keep pulling stuff out of it. Eventually, you know, we're going to hit the core of the earth and there's no more digging. So you can rip that Band-Aid off now very quickly, or you can take your time and rip it off slowly. You know, we use duct tape in the military, so it's different, but it's still as painful. And I'd recommend let's do what we need to do, because we have something to invest in now. So let's invest in it now versus waiting 2 or 3 or 4 years and having nothing to invest in. $97 isn't 100. I shied away from triple digits because when you go buy a car, $99.95 is a really good price, but 10 grand, that's just, I can't afford that. It's psychological, but it's also true. I think the board put together a very good proposal. I'm 100% in support of it. We have delayed the inevitable cost of inflation, and we have tried to be very amicable with the policies and the programs that we offer the students, still giving a quality education at a very good, reasonable price. But at some point, you know, you cannot fight inflation, and it's affected all of us. What has not gone up in the last 5 years, 2 years? The cost of being educated at Maricopa County. And unfortunately, or fortunately, however you look at it, I think it's time to do that. Those are my comments.
Thank you, Mr. Burnett. Board members, I'm not going to call roll for conversation. Anyone want to offer discussion next?
President Sullivan?
Yes, Ms.
Just a couple of questions that I think is an information that may be useful just for the conversation. And I don't know exactly who the right person is to answer each of those, but
I heard microphone.
Can you not hear me?
There you go.
And perhaps if I could start with Ms. Granillo, I have just a couple of basic questions. First of all, I want to go back to the conversation about the $97 per credit hour proposal. If we do that, my understanding is that this will, this should be sufficient in the budget arena, that we will not be having this conversation again next year or even potentially the following year. Is that an accurate presumption?
let me make sure everybody can hear me. President Sullivan, Ms. Bittersmith. So I can't guarantee that we won't have tuition discussions into the future. $97 does bridge the gap that we were trying to bridge for fiscal 24. With originally, we were looking at a smaller tuition increase and then implementing differential tuition. And as I've shared, we're not at a space yet where we can do differential tuition. I do think that will be our focus for fiscal 25. And so we may not need to do a basic tuition increase for fiscal 25. Certainly, I don't think so with a $10 or $12 basic tuition increase for fiscal 24. I'll continue to say, though, that we don't know what we don't know yet. We have the information we have available to us today. I can't guarantee what's going to happen next year or the year after that. So I'm a little bit reluctant to make guarantees that I don't want to have to back away from later on. I think, though, the system's intention would certainly be, and always is, to limit the increases to the students as much as we possibly can and see if there are other ways we can do things. I think everybody's aware we've done budget reductions as well. And really how we've approached trying to get to a balanced budget is that two-pronged approach, using budget reductions, as well as then looking at revenues. And really the only lever we have in this space is tuition. So I do think that as a system, we are committed to limiting tuition increases to only when we really need to do so. I don't know if that answers your question.
Generally, you actually predicted my follow-up question, which is we have been talking about the budget reductions that have happened as we've had work study conversations on this topic. Can you just, in a high altitude approach, remind us of where those budget reductions have occurred?
Certainly. So up through fiscal 23, we have reduced district-wide budgets by $18 million or 2.5%. Those reductions have come from the colleges and the district office divisions, and they've come in various forms depending on what business unit needed to do in order to reduce their budget by that 2.5%. And as I understand it, many of the reductions have come from eliminating vacant positions. They've also come from reallocating positions from maybe where you had a vacancy and you figured out you didn't have to have it there, so you moved it to another place that was more critical. We've also held vacancies open longer in order to create some vacancy savings to allow one-time expenditures that otherwise we wouldn't have been able to do. We've also delayed refreshing technology. We've delayed refreshing furniture or those kinds of things that we try to keep, you know, at least decent and workable for our employees and our students. We've also looked at reducing, the largest reduction we did in fiscal 23 was to cease transfers from the general fund to capital. And we're using a portion of the capital allocation for that instead. So I think as I shared in the spring, some colleges had that as a line item in their budget. Others did not. So they had to go through an exercise and determine what do they get to reduce. They've reduced operational expenditures wherever they can. Unfortunately, that's where inflation starts to really be challenging to try to reduce how much you spend on utilities. It's a little bit difficult for us to do that when we need to have cooled and heated facilities for everyone involved. The plan as it stands now and what our intention is for fiscal 24, we will reduce another 1%, which is another $7 million. And everybody's working on plans to implement that now. And so that will be a total of $25.5 million for the last 3 years, or 3.5% of our budget. And then per the 5-year plan, we also have another 1% reduction slated for fiscal 25. And all of those combinations of efforts are what get us towards a balanced budget in the general fund sometime around fiscal 26 or 27.
Thank you. Then just my final question, as the students were speaking, and I saw some of this in student comments too, who were being supportive of what recommendation is to do. I think there was a perception or hopefully an anticipation of some opportunities in increased student services or making sure that student services would not be shrinking as we look at budget reductions. This may not exactly be in your wheelhouse, but I'm going to ask anyhow, and if somebody else has to answer. My presumption is, as you're looking at projected budgets that we have been reviewing, in fact, we are looking at attempting to continue to keep student services at the level, if not improve. There's not an anticipated reduction in the kinds of things that we heard several articulate students talk about that are opportunities for them on campuses. Is that accurate?
President Sullivan, Ms. Bittersmith, without knowing exactly what the plans are at the colleges for where reductions will come into play, I think it's always the intention to limit, if not avoid, student service areas for reductions. So just to be clear, and this is in the board action item as well, an increase of $10 is what is projected to fill the gap, if you will, that marches us back towards a balanced budget. If a $12 increase is approved, we do want to spend that additional $3.3 million that can be generated by that $2 million in the student success areas. We do know that that is a place where additional resources are needed. I do think that the colleges very judiciously try to keep those areas funded as much as they possibly can. But that becomes a bit of a struggle as we continue to reduce budgets. You know, we've talked, and I think we talked about this in the spring as well, that laying out that 5-year plan allows everybody to look at when reductions are planned so that they can be as strategic as possible about where to make those reductions. And an example I provided is if you have 2 vacant positions in 2 different areas, you can make a choice as to which one you're going to fill. Unfortunately, though, they don't always happen in the strategic locations we want them. So everybody then tries to figure out how do we move things around in order to keep the business functions that we need in play. And student affairs, student services, student support efforts are always front of mind at our colleges.
Thank you. President Sullivan, I have another set of questions. They are not in Ms. Granillo's area. Do I have time to ask those?
Yeah, absolutely. I wondered if Dr. Gonzalez, though, could maybe put some comment on top of Mrs. Granillo about potential thinking around the additional $3.3 million with the $97 base before we move into your next set.
That'd be helpful. Thank you.
Sure. Thank you, Ms. Granillo.
Sure. Thank you, President Sullivan, and thank you for your questions, Mrs. Bittersmith. That's leading to this conversation, the opportunity to speak to the potential for an additional $3 million. As we are approaching the final stages of our strategic plan and also recognizing that the way that we educate and support students has been fundamentally changed by the pandemic, there's a heavier reliance on services that are provided at a distance in addition to what we already are doing in person. So when we talk, we speak very generally about being able to use these dollars to support the students by providing or strengthening, enhancing some existing supports, and then finding new ways to do the same. So I don't have a list in front of me of absolutes that we would do, but I can assure you that that's where these dollars would likely be spent.
Thank you. Thank you. Back to you, Ms. Bittersmith.
My only other couple of questions are in the communications arena, so I don't know. I've seen Mr. Coolidge standing, so he's probably stuck. I'm sorry. there are really 2 questions. I know that your team was tasked with doing some student outreach, and obviously we saw students this evening. Can you just do a quick brief recap of the communities that were touched, what you generally heard? And we've seen some of that in the staff report, obviously, but from us to better understand, you know, did we get to everybody, did we get to all campuses, and how was that mechanism set up?
Madam President, members of the board, Chancellor Gonzalez, CEC members, my name is Chuck Coolidge with the district. As the governing board directed us to do, we put together 6 different student forums, as we called them. 3 were in person, 3 were via online, just to get as much reach as possible as fast as we could and make sure that we got as much feedback as possible. Just wanted to take a quick second and say thank you to the students for taking your time on a weekday a little bit later than normally expected, and Appreciate your input and joining us today. A lot of those students joined us. We had about 66 total attendees for those meetings. Within those 66 attendees, we had a fair amount of feedback, which I believe all of you received. 93% of that feedback was positive for this tuition increase, which at least for someone like me was very shocking. And frankly, I think a lot of the students were in the thought process of this is going to help us and here are the reasons why. We accumulated all of that information and we tried to cultivate it for y'all without touching any of the wording, just so you could see it clear. We also have the video that we used in the rationale behind building this video mainly was to torture Ms. Granillo, but otherwise really have a cookie cutter way to deliver the same message to every single student, faculty member and community member that joined us in those forums so that they got the exact same feedback from what we needed them to have a better understanding as far as our ask of them and the communications. Happy to tee that up now if you'd like to see it. I know that all of you may or may not have received that link. If that's something you'd like to see, we can tee it up. Otherwise, happy to answer any questions. And I hope that answered your overview.
Generally, just one follow-up, Mr. Coolidge. Obviously, when you talk about the sheer number, it doesn't sound like a large number of students given our entire enrollment population. So help me understand, were those students, were they elected leaders for the respective college governing bodies? I mean, the speakers tonight were clearly all from the elected, from the Student Senate, and we've seen them before as student leaders. But is that reflective of the folks that participated in watching the video and participating in the online forums? Were they indeed representatives that have been elected by other students at their colleges?
Madam President, members of the board, we did do a significant amount of outreach to the Student Senate, as you've seen, and we shot a note to our entire student population, hoping that we could engage them in all three in persons. And again, why we decided to engage via a virtual space, just because we know a lot of the students are at home or whatever they may be doing. We had a fairly quick turnaround time, so we gave them as much heads up as possible, which was, I believe, 3 to 4 days before we had to deliver the information. And of that, we had a pretty significant kind of holistic view of the schools in general that were represented. As far as the Student Senate goes, we had representatives from all 10 schools. Very happy about that.
And then my final question, President Sullivan, I promise. It's okay. In terms of going forward, whatever the action is of the board tonight, I'm presuming that your team will be dealing with how that gets communicated appropriately in a timely fashion as students look forward to enrollment for fall of 2023. And I don't need details. I just want to understand that there is a rollout plan in terms of how to deal with that. And again, as people are making those decisions and choices.
President Sullivan, members of the board, yes, we do have a pretty detailed plan already put together. Obviously, we didn't know the path of which way the board would go. So we do have flexible plans with how that is. I know you don't want nitty details, but we will be bookending a significant amount of that messaging with other ways that students can go and receive tuition help in a number of different areas. So we'll be looping in the foundation and others to see if we can lessen the load on students at risk.
Thank you very much. Thank you, President Sullivan.
Certainly. Thank you. Board members, other points for discussion? Mrs. McGrath is nodding. Would you like Mr. Coolidge to stay at the podium or?
I'd love to have him stay there and he's pleasant to look at, but I do need to speak with Ms. Granillo.
That cost me a lot of money, so I appreciate that.
Mrs. McGrath. Since you are going off the board, I think we're few on that one, but please go ahead.
You mean to tell me you like girls better than boys?
I'm not offering any comment.
Ms. Granillo, please. Ms. Granillo, you said something that triggered a remembrance in me. I think it was about 2016 that we discovered that 8% of the money that we had was being set aside as a reserve. And we discovered that if we increase that to 10%, that we could then pay for all of our M&O and we would not have to ever go out for a bond issue again. And when you said tonight something about M&O, I thought, are we going into those funds? Are we reducing them? What's going on with those funds?
President Sullivan, Mrs. McGrath, first of all, I'm gonna not be offended that you wouldn't prefer to look at me rather than Chuck.
Oh my God.
No, it's just I prefer guys rather than girls. Nothing against
you. I'm gonna have to turn off your mics.
I just couldn't let that one pass, Mrs. McGrath. I missed having you in person, so I'm glad to see you today.
I wouldn't let that go by either.
What you're referring to is our financial stability reserve that we have set aside, and you're right. We moved that from 8% to 10%, and that is in the general fund. At the same time, what we did is we started implementing what we've called the tax shift, which is as we've paid down our GO bonds or general obligation bonds from our 2004 bond program, we've taken the money we saved in lower debt service and shifted that to our capital program. So it's become now taxpayer funded capital program, which we've primarily used for deferred maintenance. And as we know, we've got 300 plus million in deferred maintenance, as many institutions do have. And that tax shift is the approach that we have employed to try to not need to do a GO bond issue again in the future or GO bond program in the future. So those two things are really separate. The financial stability resides in the general fund, so that's for operating activities. And the tax shift is in the capital fund, which is for, again, primarily deferred maintenance and other capital activities as those arise instead of issuing bonds.
Thank you. And I really appreciate the huge learning curve that you have been on in this new position that you have taken upon, and you've done an excellent job with it. I thank you very much for your
thank you for that, Mrs. McGrath. I appreciate it.
Mrs. McGrath, do you have any other comments or questions?
No, I think I've probably said enough that I'm lucky to make it out of the building alive tonight.
As long as you don't bring up certain discussions, you're welcome to the podium and we'll be gently escorted out of the building. Okay, moving on, but thank you. Board members, anyone else?
I'd like to talk to Mr. Coolidge and we'll not make any further comments.
Thank you, Mrs. Wynn.
How many total students received a request to be surveyed? What was the total number of impressions that you sent out?
Madam President, members of the board, looking for Dr. Brock. I actually do not have that information. She sent it out to the entire listserv of students, which I know, but I do not have the exact number from that listserv.
Rough it for me, 5,000, 10,000, 20. 42,000.
May I phone a friend?
Yes.
Sounds like that number will be soon, so hopefully I'll be able to delay you until that happens.
Well, I'm going to we'll get that number.
Yes, ma'am.
I'm going to say that 66 students responded, half of which are our student leaders. So that whatever that number is, and we're going to get that soon, that's a really low. And should we assume that if they didn't respond, that they had no interest or that they don't want their tuition raised? Because I think that non-response speaks very loudly to the response. And I think we're making a grave error if we think that 66 students saying, I want my tuition raised represents 10 college campuses. And I think I appreciate the enthusiasm with which those 66 speak. But I think we should be very careful to say that that represents our student body.
Madam President, members of the board, is that a question? And if so,
it'll be a question when I have the number, because then I'll give me a person.
The thought process behind really making sure that we had a significant conversation with the student senate was as they represent their schools. I know a lot of these student senators had a lot of tough conversations with those, with their colleagues.
Okay.
And the feedback that they've been able to gather, and the role of a student senator is to represent those 10 schools, which is why we were so excited to be able to have all of that representation for the large first meeting. As far as the rollout across the campuses, with all due respect, I'm not sure that we can say and this from our previous worlds, a lack of voting means a no vote, but right. I understand where you're coming from, and
I guess if they don't vote or they don't respond, they didn't read or they didn't see it. And I think my concern is
possibly
that now there's going to be a tuition increase and they're going to have missed this poll and they didn't get to participate. And I'm not doubting the student leaders going out and talking to the students. I just am concerned about did we really do this? And I think you and I had a separate conversation about the amount of money being increased, which is it's per credit hour. So it's not $10 per class, it's $30 per class. And if you're taking a full load, that could be $120 to $150 increase per semester, or like our student leader said, $300. And for some students, that could be the difference between them continuing or taking much longer to stay in college. So I just want to be responsible for that. We're now talking about imposing this, and our enrollment is still, I believe, growing, but it's still a problem. And do we now cripple our enrollment by raising tuition at a time when we have high inflation?
Madam President, members of the board, again, not a direct question, but I'll touch on as many points as possible.
Thank you.
The first point would be, as far as enrollment goes, I know we're making significant strides on our end to increase enrollment in a number of different ways. I think you're going to see Prop 308 be a pretty significant driver on top of a significant amount of changes that we've been putting in on our end in marketing and some focus that will be happening internally in the district to continue that growth. As far as, like you said, hopefully COVID's gone forever and all the other things that have been happening. As far as the student population that we communicated with, a $10, or we didn't say $10, we said a per credit hour increase. So it was communicated, and happy to have any of the student senators stand up if they don't think that we had communicated a per hour, but sounds like we do have that number as well.
Thank you.
Good evening, Board President Sullivan and Mrs. Nguyen. So apologies for the scrambling here. So we sent it out to all current students enrolled in spring semester, excluding dual enrollment students. So approximately 70,000 students received the message. Okay. It was pretty clear with regard to what we were asking them to participate in. And I will say historically, we see large numbers of participation historically from our student senators and our student groups when we send out calls for engagement around activities, feedback loops, focus groups. And so it's not uncharacteristic that our student leaders stepped up, because that is very much part of the engagement that they, the role that they serve at our colleges.
For the benefit of those people online, would you please introduce yourself?
Oh, my apologies. Bettina Salas, Acting Vice Chancellor, ASA.
Thank you.
As you can tell, we actually did phone a friend on that. So
I love it. Delay. I wish I had more money to hand out for the game. I think I appreciate, number one, your marketing efforts that you're doing. I still believe that we need to improve our enrollment. And if the money that we're trying to get by this doesn't increase our enrollment, we're going to be in that situation that Ms. Grineo said about, we're going to have to come back and do something else, because it's not going to achieve the outcome that you want to achieve. And I just wonder if this is premature to do this, not that we shouldn't do it, but that it's premature to do it right now, because we don't have enough data and we don't know if this is the solution, if there's not maybe more cuts to be made at the colleges. So that's why I wanted to know what what this number represented. It's less, it's a very small percentage. If you've got 70,000 students and you've got 66 responses, to me, it's not a response. And I'm not doubting the students and their commitment. I'm just worried about, we're now going to increase our tuition at this campus at a time when we are the highest inflation rate in the country. And it's the most expensive place to live is in our community college district in the country. And now we're going to raise tuition. And does that cripple your marketing efforts to bring students into our college? And I'm afraid that one may not serve the other. So it's again, not a question. You don't need to comment. And I appreciate your efforts to do everything that you're doing. And thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
I think you're dismissed, Mr. Cook.
Yes.
At least for now. You never know. Mrs. Nguyen, any further comment or question?
I think I'm good. Thank you, Mrs. Sullivan.
Thank you. I've been, Mr. Burnett, one more follow-up, and then I'll move to Dr. Nerini and then Ms. Smith.
Okay, I'll try to make this brief. Mrs. Nguyen mentioned the highest inflation in Maricopa County versus the rest of the country, and I think as a college system, we've been fighting that. We've been trying to abstain from joining the ranks of the overinflated, and I can appreciate the fact that there was not, 6,000 students on that call, but quite frankly, the timing demanded urgency, and there wasn't as much. I feel confident that if we had more time, we probably could have got more involvement, but at the same time, it was something that we needed to get feedback from. I spoke with the senators putting this thing together. We did an emergency meeting with them and got some of their initial feedback. And I know for a fact, after talking to two of the senators, that they actually created documents that they emailed out to all the students at their school so they could get feedback from their students in written form. Matt's not here, but I know he was one that did it. And it was a time sensitive matter. But I wouldn't look at the number personally as 66 being small, although it is. I think it's more of a, in my mind, a collective agreement that premature, I think it's overdue. We have a difference of opinion, but I think it's overdue. And we can wait, and we can wait. And we can have a $25 increase, 2 years from now to try to get caught back up. I just think we should, we're in a hole. We need to stop digging and we need to fill in that hole so we can be on level ground and we have a place to go. This isn't about us because most of us are students here. We won't be here as students a year from now or 2 years from now. And really we're trying to plan for the students that are coming in beyond us. This has got to be bigger than just looking at the student body going from 22 to 23 and going, they're going to get a $12 per hour increase. That's the myopic view. The big 30,000 foot view is, are we still competitive in the market with the rest of the schools in the Valley, the rest of the schools in the country? Do we still offer a quality education for a good price? And I think the answer to that as a student is yes. Notwithstanding the board members all have education, they all went to school. But as a student that's in school right now and a father, single parent, I don't think it cripples me. I don't think it cripples most people. I think we might be overstating that $10 a credit hour cripples people. I just don't think it does. That's just my viewpoint. That's personal probably, but. Okay.
Mr. Bennett, thank you very much for your comments. I have Dr. Nerini just part of the discussion, then Ms. Smith, and then I understand Dr. Thor as well. At the conclusion of our discussion, I will call the question for the vote. So Dr. Nerini.
Thank you, Ms. Sullivan. I'm sure it's no surprise to anybody that when it comes to raising the cost for students, it's difficult for me. So once we started talking about tuition and this sort of thing, I dove into doing some research and I crawled down several rabbit holes, but I found some pretty interesting little tidbits. Like for one thing, we're pretty darn amazing. When you consider what we're doing with the resources we have, I did research, there's 850 public two-year schools in the United States. Only 148 of them charge more than we do. 100 of those are in California, where California literally gives billions of dollars to their community colleges, right? So I think our faculty and our staff and administration has done a wonderful job with what we have. Because back between 2008 and 2015, Arizona had the largest decrease in state funding for higher education than any other state in the country. We cut our state funding by 47%, and we're still trying to get back with that. They cut us by 85%. Let's face it. The reason we have to do this is because those folks down on 17th Avenue in Washington aren't doing their job. They're sitting on a $5 billion debt budget surplus, right? They're not doing their job, so we have to. We have to be brave enough to do this. When we look at the trends of college pricing and student aid that was put out by College Board, when we adjust for inflation, our tuition has actually gone down 16% in the state of Arizona. So if we expect our faculty and staff to continue providing students the kind of quality education that we have been providing, we need to step up, because those folks, until we can get those folks on Washington to do their job and provide education at the lowest possible cost, then we have to take it upon ourselves. Here's something else that kind of drives home that point. When it comes to state financial aid for students, 0.1, not 1%, but 0.1% of all the financial, of all the money that goes into education goes to fund financial aid for students. Of that, there's $11 million that goes into that. Community colleges get $600,000. The state's not doing their job. That's 154% difference between what a community college student can expect and what a university student can expect in terms of financial aid from the state. Which brings me to another point and related point, as we're talking about inflation and all these other things. Tuition, keep in mind, tuition is only one part of what it costs a student to go to school, right? We talk about cost of attendance. Cost of attendance includes books. Cost of attendance includes room and board. It costs all the course fees and that sort of thing. So a few weeks ago, we received a budget for the cost of attendance. Now stick with me here. So the budget for a full-time, first-time student for tuition, what we're using to award their financial aid, is $918 per semester. So let's think about that, $918 per semester. In order to be a full-time student, you have to take 12 credits. 12 times 85, help me out, $1,020. So that budget, what we're using for the cost of education, doesn't even cost that. And I understand how it works. And we're taking all the students and we're dividing them by the number of classes, and we come up with eight, because our students are on average are taking 8 credits, right? But that doesn't work for a full-time student. And if we expect our students to graduate in 2 years, because we're a 2-year college, that student's gonna have to take 15 credits, right? 15 credits, which is gonna leave them, about $400 short. And that's not even including the course fees. That's just including the fee for the loan and the fee for registration. So as we move forward with this, and we do need to look at all this, we need to look at the issues. We need to look at the issues of expected, or the cost of attendance, the whole cost of attendance. We need to look at the net price calculator that we have on our system, that we're using data from 2019 to 2020 for a federally mandated requirement, right? We need to look at this. And so I hope, as we move forward with the decision, we do take a deeper dive into all the issues that students are facing when it comes to paying for their education. And you're right, it is for students now, but it is for the students in the future. But inflation is going up, and it's not just going up for the students, it's going up for the institution as well. So I hope that after we take the vote, we can look at raising tuitions and still lower the cost for the students. I think that Dr. Lisa Young and what her group is doing with open enrollment or open educational resources, we've brought down the cost of books by millions in the last few years because of the work that they've done. So I think there's more that we can do. We talk about how we make cuts in the budget for the institution. We need to look at how we can reduce the cost for the students as well. So with that said, I just hope that as we move forward, we can look at all the aspects of what it costs a student to attend one of our institutions, what it costs for them to get that degree. Because yes, the cost of return on investment is huge for the students, and it's huge for the community. So next time we talk to an industry leader and they complain about the lack of quality workforce, let's just point to that $5 billion surplus on Washington. And say that's why, because they're not doing their job to help us provide that quality workforce that is so desperately needed. So that's all I have to say.
Thank you very much, Dr. Nerini. Ms. Smith.
Thank you very much. So I want to offer a few reflections. As Ms. Grineo indicated, this may not be the last time we are facing a tuition increase. If not next year, then certainly at some point in the future, we will find ourselves in this situation again. So as I reflect on where we are today, I want to offer a few suggestions to the chancellors, to the presidents, and others here about how we might improve, how we move on this process moving forward. I share Ms. Wynn's concerns about the number of responses that were received, and in the future would love to see us also look at distributing videos directly to students, distributing a video and an email to the 70,000 students, and checking and monitoring email click rates, checking the number of views of the video itself, and actually trying to re-engage students. And I think part of why we're here today is that we were, you all had about 3 or 4 days to generate these responses. So trying to be more mindful of giving ourselves more time and more space to plan for these kinds of increases so that we can have a broader reach of the students when we're gathering their feedback electronically. I'd also like to hear more from financial aid counselors and better understand from their perspective how this will affect their day-to-day. And would love to hear how, after an increase occurs, how that changes the nature of the financial aid counselor's interaction with the student. I hope that in the next fiscal year, we can get some reports from the 10 colleges about what we're hearing from students, about whether the tuition increase did in fact have an impact on them. For some, if they are full-time students, a approximate $300 or $400 annual increase may not be crippling, but that is an assumption. So I do hope that in a year's time, we can check our hypothesis and determine what the impacts were on the student population of this increase, and not only better assess the impact on the students, assess whether our financial aid counselors are equipped to help offer suggestions to those students for how they meet those needs. I also hope that the feedback that we receive from the financial aid counselor is given to Mr. Spicker and his colleagues in the development area. And I hope that this leads to increased fundraising for scholarships and increased fundraising across the board for student success. And I hope this is a moment to really emphasize student needs. And as Dr. Nerini is speaking about, this is a moment to re-engage the state. I think this is also a moment to re-engage philanthropically. Those are my comments for now. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Smith. Mr. Spicker, I noticed you're in the audience, and so I might put you on the spot here. Can you speak to the role of philanthropy in addressing student needs as you see it and where you see this going forward, please? Just as a brief update. And I know you didn't know that you're just sitting right there within eye contact.
I pushed the button.
Yeah.
The foundation is really has several fold parts to this conversation. One is the cost of attendance, which was not really on our radar until COVID hit. We were doing student supports about $11,000 each year. It's now $500,000. And so we're really pivoting the conversation in philanthropy for more student support. We were just seen as a scholarshiping institution, and that's where the bulk of our dollars are right now. They sit in the scholarship, they're endowed funds, and they have very specific criteria. But last year we were able to produce 3 million in scholarships, and so that continues to grow. In terms of our ability to capture the attention of the community around philanthropic needs for our students and colleges. It's really important from both a marketing perspective and a messaging perspective. And so we'll continue to work with marketing, we'll continue to work with the community to increase our philanthropic giving. It will not fill the void that Kim Granillo has been speaking about in terms of the economic model. Those dollars are tied up in very specific ways at the foundation. We will continue to grow. We grew 113% last year. And as we move into what we see as a more difficult economic environment, we're going to do our darndest to raise money for our students. Is that?
Yeah. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Just a moment. For those online, would you introduce yourself and your title and what you do, please?
Thank you, Ms. McGrath. I'm Brian Spicker. I'm the president and CEO of the Maricopa Community Colleges Foundation. Thank you.
And Mrs. McGrath's absent. In the future, we're going to put a tent there, and it's going to say, please identify yourself. And I think that is a great idea. Thank you, Mrs. McGrath. And also another comment, Ms. Smith, you made the comment about the financial aid work session. We already have plans in the works to do that. I believe it was Dr. Gonzalez, January or February, and where we've talked about a financial aid work session. And I think it's just been a matter of what works for the financial aid staff, including the counselors, to your point. And as far as the technology, yes, we will be challenging PR marketing to look at different ways to gather data. So your points are well made and on target with what is, I understand, already being considered. So thank you very much for bringing those up and to the point. So last person, Dr. Thor.
Thank you, President Sullivan. I want to begin by also thanking the students for being here tonight. And I want to repeat what I said at the work session where we were presented with information about a potential tuition increase that our students are very smart. And you recognize that you are getting a quality education at a very affordable price, and that it is important to maintain the quality of not only our instructional programs, but our services. It is not an easy decision for us to raise tuition on our students, because we all care deeply about students and particularly student success. We also were elected to be trustees of these 10 colleges. And that means that we have a responsibility to ensure that the colleges do offer quality programs and services, and that we are accessible, responsive, and of course, also affordable. I remember having been a president in this district from 1990 to 2010, that the Maricopa colleges always had the highest tuition in the state. Today, there are 6 districts with higher tuition than Maricopa charges. And we have not raised tuition since the fiscal year, or the academic year, I believe 16-17, and actually rolled tuition back by a dollar in 18. And that was at the same time, approximate same time, that the state was disinvesting in the Maricopa community colleges and cut, I believe, about $38 million out of our budget. I have been on the board since that last tuition increase of 16 to 17. And now that I look at the data and see that had we been keeping the tuition where it was responding to the inflation, tuition would be $110 a credit hour. Significantly higher than what we're proposing to do today. So I know others are expressing concern that we might be back next year or the year after that looking at tuition increases. Well, I now feel that we were neglectful in not being attentive to the tuition and the financial strain that it was causing on the district budget by not looking at it every year. So I hope that by policy that this board begins to build a review of tuition as it relates to other factors into our annual budgetary considerations. And that concludes my comments. Thank you.
Thank you. Following up on one of your comments, Dr. Thor, when you said we're the six, can you give us a range of what you perceive as our competitors and what they're providing in tuition? And there's rumor that there's going to be percentage increases. I think Dr. Nerini, you brought that to my attention this evening about.
So I was referencing the chart that we were provided at the study session, and the highest tuition in the state is Coconino at $113, followed next by Yavapai at 98, then Graham at 93, Cochise at 91, no, I'm sorry, Yuma La Paz at 92, Cochise at 91. The only districts that charge less today of in tuition are Mojave, Navajo, and Pinal, although Pinal up until the pandemic charged more tuition than Maricopa did.
Thank you. And Dr. Nerini, you gave me a tidbit of information this evening. You heard about another.
Yeah, I thought I heard on the radio coming in that Grand Canyon was going to be increasing their tuition, Grand Canyon University. I didn't get the exact amount, but.
You know. I see. Okay. So with that, we've had a good discussion this evening. Are there any other comments or points of discussion from governing board members before I call the question for the vote? Since I made the motion, everyone must know where I stand on this position. My belief that it is the way we invest in students is by providing a quality education focused on excellent programs, thinking through the program intentions. And I want to express my appreciation to you students this evening who chose to come. And I also want to express my appreciation to those who participated in any forums, and if you could pass that on to your constituents as your representatives, please do so on our behalf. Thank you. All right, board, I'm going to call the vote. I'm going to start with our student trustee, Mr. Lynn Burnett. We have the motion on the floor to, with a second, to increase our base tuition rate to $97 a credit hour. So Mr. Burnett, your vote, please.
Aye.
Thank you. I will then move in honor of those being your last votes. Mrs. McGrath.
Nay.
Okay. Mrs. Nguyen.
Nay.
Dr. Thor, since you made the second the motion.
Aye.
Thank you. Dr. Nerini.
With courage and conviction to providing our students with the best possible education, and the conviction and courage that's lacking at the state capitol, I vote aye.
Thank you. Ms. Bittersmith?
Madam President, with the understanding, what I heard tonight, that our commitment is that there is a substantial amount of money, whether it's $3.5 million allocated potentially coming out of this tuition increase for student services, I will vote aye.
Thank you. Ms. Smith?
I vote aye.
Thank you. My vote is aye as well. That means that the measure passes 5-2 with our student trustee also voting with the majority. So I want to say thank you to the diligence and hard work, Dr. Gonzalez, of the teams, to students who participated in the activity, to all of you who have contributed information to Ms. Granillo. Ms. Granillo, thank you for your presentations multiple times. You're not done. We will be seeing you in the future. We have some more budget meetings to schedule. And keeping in mind, Dr. Gonzalez, we do want to consider the financial aid work session sooner than later and other points. And to Ms. Bittersmith's comment also about our intention to see that that money might be targeted to student success. You now have the opportunity and the responsibility to communicate and be transparent about our vote and our reasons why. So thank you for that.
President Sullivan, may Mayor clarify the vote that has taken place just to ensure that we have this correct. The agenda item, in addition to the $12 increase, also addresses the 150% charge for a bachelor's degree. Reread that. And my assumption is that the vote is inclusive of the other items that were on this agenda item.
Yes, I apologize, but using the $97 as the base figure for those considerations, yes. Thank you. We'll move on through the agenda to the first read of employment and separations for October 15, 2022 through November 4, 22. Are there any comments or questions from board members? Being none, we'll move to this item two, proposed 2023 Maricopa Community Colleges District Governing Board meeting. Schedule is under review. We do know that on January 10, the governing board will meet for a special meeting for the election of officers and a gender review to be followed by the regularly scheduled meeting on January 24. We also move into monitoring reports, budget analysis, report fund one. It's a final unaudited statement. Are there any comments and questions on that? Being none, we'll move forward to any community linkage comments. Mr. Burnett, do you have anything to report?
Nothing to report.
Thank you, Ms. Bittersmith.
Thank you, President Sullivan. Just briefly, I want to add my thank yous and congratulations to Mrs. Nguyen and Mrs. McGrath. Honestly, Ms. Smith and I have been, I think, in exactly in maybe two meetings in person with both of these board members, but obviously they have been very much a part of our learning and training experience, even virtually remotely. So I want to say thank you and congratulations to both of them. In addition, just quickly, I wanted to mention that Ms. Smith and I and Dr. Gonzalez participated in a meeting with Dr. Crow on Friday about partnerships. I will let them add content to the value of that meeting. And my final comment is that several of us have found ourselves put on ACCT committees, like it or not. We have more volunteer service to do, but I'm pleased to tell you I will be on the public policy committee. I will let other board members enlighten you as to which committees they have been appointed to. And with that, I will just say happy holidays and thank you all for staying so late for this meeting.
Thank you, Ms. Bittersmith. Ms. McGrath.
Thank you for the opportunity to again say thank you for the opportunity to serve with these wonderful, wonderful people.
Thank you, Mrs. McGrath. Dr. Nerini.
Thank you, Ms. McGrath and Ms. Nguyen for all serving your service. I appreciate that and happy to your next moves. I was selected to be part of ACCT's diversity committee, so I was pretty excited to get that nomination and get that approval. With that, just happy holidays for everybody.
Thank you. Ms. Smith.
And congratulations and thank you to board members McGrath and Nguyen for your service. Thank you so much. And to the meeting that board member Bittersmith alluded to, we did meet with ASU President Michael Crow. Given the chancellor's permanent appointment, President Crow is interested in extending his invitation for partnership and commitment to learners across the state of Arizona. And I think a variety of technologies and areas for collaboration were introduced and will continue to be explored in the next calendar year. And I wish everyone a happy holiday. That concludes my report. Thank you.
Thank you. Dr. Thor.
Thank you. I also want to congratulate the outgoing board members. And I want to wish the students good luck. This is finals week for you, so we hope that it all goes well. Dr. Gonzalez mentioned that the League for Innovation is holding its Executive Leadership Institute this week. And I am privileged to be a consultant to the Executive Leadership Institution. We have 38 aspiring college presidents from around the country with us, and I am very proud that there are 8 Maricopans included in this year's cohort, representing 6 of our colleges and the district office. I also want to report that this morning, Dr. Gonzalez did a 90-minute presentation on leadership change and organizational culture. And Sandra Hinsky is one of our ELI participants this year, and I think that she can attest that your presentation was awesome. In fact, the participants talked about it throughout the rest of the day. So I want everyone to know that he not only represented us well, but he had future community college presidents from around the country awestruck. So I was very, very proud. I want to take this opportunity at the end of the year to also thank the faculty and staff and administrators of our colleges and our district office for the great job that you do, and to wish everybody a happy holiday.
Thank you. Ms. Nguyen?
I'll keep this short. I think that we have a lot of excellence in this college system, and I will look forward from afar to see all the many accomplishments that happen under our new leadership and the different roles that will be filled. I will trust that you will always put the students first. They are the reason that we exist, and it's the most important thing that we do is to build leaders. I hope that we put excellence as our the thing that is the most important, that we create excellent leaders, that we can that we create excellence in our community, and that we strive to be the very best at what we do, and that we do it for the most affordable price. On that, I wish you all a very, very Merry Christmas, and I'll look forward to seeing the success of this next board. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ms. Nguyen. So my report for the evening is, since Mrs. Bittersmith has alluded to it, I also was appointed to a committee at ACCT, and I will be on the Governance and Bylaws Committee, in addition to serving on the Regional Nominating Committee for the next year for board members to ACCT. So gives new meaning to volunteerism. Anyway, so thank you. I had the opportunity yesterday to have lunch with Mr. G. Hengley from ACCT. It was a pleasurable experience to have lunch with him. He did ask lots of inquiring questions about the governing board. So I certainly hope he walks away knowing that we have our act together. So with that was interesting. I want to also remind folks that tomorrow we're hosting an onboarding for the two newly elected governing board members, Ms. Donna Davis, who's in the audience this evening, and Ms. Kelly Butler, who will be joining us. I want to thank the staff who has put that together. The other piece that was given to us rather last minute is we will be sworn in with the oath of office so that we can be ready to rock and roll on January 1. And I'll be part of that swearing in ceremony as I also begin a new term on January 1. Lots of thanks this evening. I mean, first of all, thank you all for the content of the meeting that provided us with the information and guidance we needed as a governing board to make a decision. That is our role, after all, where we both take risks and show courage in making hard decisions and consider the impact and ramifications. I do want to assure the students in the room that we do feel tremendous responsibility to your participation in this system, and we'll continue to do and strive to do our best
to make decisions that will offer you the best opportunities there are. So thank you to our board members for making that commitment to excellence. Also want to thank all of the folks who have contributed so much this year, just generally, that's staff and administration and faculty and adjunct faculty. Yeah, see you back there, all of you. So thank you for that. And I want to also extend our appreciation to Elsa, who puts all of these evenings together. Under duress sometimes. So thank you. Thank you, security, for being here with us this evening. We know we called upon you. I hope you were able to enjoy the refreshments in the back of the room. And you can take a few cookies home if there are any left, of course. And just in general, I want to wish everyone a very happy holiday experience season. Please be sure to spend some time with those you care about, love, cherish, hold dear, whatever the expression works for you, and to find opportunities for your own renewal. That's after all what we do at the end of a time and beginning of a new one. So please ensure that you do that. To Mr. Saar, you held in with us all evening. Good for you. Yay. Thank you and good continued work with your K-12 district experience and work. And you're part of our faculty and staff, so that expression of thanks goes to you in that regard. And finally, to my colleagues, Ms. McGrath and Ms. Nguyen, thank you for your service. May God be with you as you move forward. Godspeed. And I need to call on Dr. Gonzalez.
Yes, President Sullivan, thank you. I'd like to take a moment to recognize someone who's, this will also be their last governing board meeting in an official capacity. It's Dr. Mark Cohen. He is retiring and will be going on into the sunset. That's what he says. Mark, how many years have you spent with Maricopa? 11 and a half years. And in 11 and a half years, Mark came to Phoenix College, and then at a critical time in Maricopa's history, stepped up to the plate and began to serve, as many of us do, in interim capacities before becoming permanent leaders in our organization. And he proved his ability and his worth in that position. And in his time has really helped put Maricopa back on the map in terms of innovation and technology. He has literally saved the district millions of dollars. He has made our district safer. He has led us through cyber attacks. You guys know what he's done here. So let's give him a round of applause. Mark, please do not fail retirement. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Gonzalez, and Godspeed to you as well as you move forward. Thank you for all your contributions. Okay, board, I'm going to adjourn us at 8:50 p.m. And to all of you, happy holidays and good evening. Thank you. Bye.